Welcome to Health Sciences Update. I'm Taryn Roloff, director of the WSU Spokane Health Sciences Campus. Joining me today is Dr. Jae Kennedy. He is the director of the Health Policy and Administration Program here on the Health Sciences Campus in Spokane. Welcome, Dr. Kennedy.
Thank you.
So tell us a little bit about the Health Policy and Administration Program here.
The program's about 20 years old. It's a master's program, kind of a professional terminal degree like an MBA. We've got about 40 to 45 students currently in the program. It's 2 years of full-time residential study here with an internship requirement between the first and second summer. It's nationally ranked and accredited, and it's a really great resource for the Spokane medical community. We're very proud of it.
And you said earlier that it's actually the first department here.
It was the first department recognized and fully established off of the Pullman campus. That happened about 18 years ago or so, but we've been at the Spokane campus since our inception.
Right, and the campus, of course, is about 26 years old, so quite a history.
Yeah.
So talk a little bit about some of your graduates. I know that they've gone on to do some pretty cool things.
Most of our graduates get jobs fairly quickly after they graduate. I think our placement rate within 3 months is over 85%, which is terrific for, you know, current employment situation. Our students work for hospitals, clinics, state and county agencies, federal agencies, not-for-profits. We've got students that are at fairly high levels in administration and local service provider settings here in the Spokane area, including the Providence Health System and the Spokane Regional Health District, and a number of our students are involved with the major expansion of CHAS, the series of not-for-profit public clinics in the Spokane area.
And you mentioned there's a couple of folks in Taiwan, you said?
We have a number of international students as well, and some of them have gone back to careers in the health systems of their countries of origin, and a couple of them have gone into academia, including a couple professors in Taiwan that are currently going up for tenure right now.
Yeah. So has the Affordable Care Act changed the interest in the HPA program here?
I think so. We've been getting a lot of applications from young people that want to be part of this, you know, very dramatic change in the healthcare system. And it's a combination of kind of business administration methodologies and then understanding the health systems and the health policy context makes for, I think, a really useful degree in the current environment.
So research is a key component of the HPA program. We'll talk a little bit about that and then some of the grants that have been just recently in the news.
We've got a couple of faculty pursuing different things related to health reform broadly. My colleague Joseph Coyne studies health payment reform. There have been a series of changes in the Affordable Care Act trying to reward providers for keeping people well rather than just providing lots of services. So new payment mechanisms actually penalize hospitals for readmissions and things like that. And that leads to some pretty dramatic changes in the way you have to budget and plan for hospitals to continue to make money with Medicare reimbursement. Sean Murphy is an assistant professor that's working on kind of the health economics of behavioral health, particularly looking at kind of the costs and benefits of providing early intervention and treatment for substance abuse and mental health services. And then my colleague Gary Smith studies rural health systems and trying to improve access. And the rural hospitals have been particularly hard hit by some of these reforms. They're losing some of their special federal funding and are trying to now compete in a different kind of environment. So trying to respond to the needs of rural communities and make sure that they get the primary care that they need is also a research focus on the campus.
So tell us a bit about some of the work that you're doing right now.
We're in the finishing up the second year of a project looking at use of antipsychotic medications in the Medicare program in Washington State. We got about a $300,000 grant funded by the Washington Attorney General's office to look at the impact of off-label prescribing of these powerful psychiatric medications in the Medicare program. So we had this fairly ambitious big data project of looking at all of the prescriptions written under Medicare Part D for Washington State, trying to identify antipsychotic users and then look at patterns of use. Are they using them for prescribed or unprescribed conditions? And, you know, what kind of variation do we see in use by age and region and type of health condition? So we're finishing up that project over the next 6 months or so. And then the other thing that this interview presumably is about is we got a grant at the beginning of the month for the Collaborative on Health Reform and Independent Living, which is a 5-year, $2.5 million grant looking at the impact of the Affordable Care Act on working age adults with disabilities. So I'm working with colleagues at the University of Kansas and George Mason University and this group called the Independent Living Resource Unit in Houston that's affiliated with Term Memorial Hospital, which is one of the magnet hospitals for rehabilitation excellence. And we are doing a bunch of things to look at the impact of the ACA. We're talking to directors of Centers for Independent Living, which are these small service centers located throughout the country, run for and by people with disabilities, that provide benefits counseling and peer support and housing assistance. And it depends on the center, but they're this resource throughout the country for disability services, and they have kind of a unique perspective on the community and the population. So we're working with them on our research, as well as coordinating with them on dissemination and utilization activities. And then we're conducting our own surveys and focus groups, but we're also using a lot of large national health surveys to look at trends in healthcare access, health insurance coverage, utilization and cost for people with disabilities compared to non-disabled groups. We're focusing on the working age population because most children are covered by their parents' plans, and most seniors, virtually all seniors, get Medicare. But for people that aren't engaged in full-time work, historically, it's been very difficult for people with chronic illness and disability to get access to private health insurance, and they've had to rely on public health insurance systems, namely Medicare and Medicaid. And we hope and hypothesize that will begin to change now that people will be able to obtain health insurance without having to get disability benefits first, and that may reduce some of the pressures on disability programs.
I just heard something on public radio about this very thing, about how the extension of the age that children can be on their parents' insurance has helped people with disabilities. Yeah. So we've had the Affordable Care Act for a year or two.
Well, it started in 2014, so
okay,
we're
right.
2015 now,
okay,
by a year
so
and a
year
half.
Out. Okay, so are you, the reason then for your grant was that there was suspicion that it would get better, or that it's gotten worse, or that it, or I know.
Well, certainly the proponents of the Affordable Care Act, you know, assume that it's going to get better, and if you look at the drop in the proportion of adults who are uninsured, there's been a significant impact. Whether that has a similar impact on people with chronic health conditions and disabilities is less clear. And although the program was fully implemented in 2014, there's a lag before you can start collecting information on this stuff. So it's a lot of our analyses are we're just able to start those now. Mm-hmm. I thought you were going to ask about the recent kind of budget negotiations to extend the life of the Social Security Disability Program, which is another issue on the news a lot. But that's not, I wouldn't say that's directly related to the ACA, although they're using those techniques to reduce Medicare costs for the whole program.
So students come to you with their a BA and they start their master's. How does research play into what they're studying?
Well, their introductory class, their Introduction to Health Systems class, requires a scientific literature review where they really need to get into the public databases and become an expert in some specific problem area. And one of the things we expect our students to be able to do is at least be sophisticated consumers of research. So they need to know how to do the reading and really, more importantly, how to bring that together into kind of actionable information that their organization can use. And they're required to do a graduate project at the end, which is typically, you know, looking at a research problem and evaluating the issue at a specific health delivery site. Often where they've done their internships, but sometimes with other partners here in the community, or in some cases doing stuff with national databases, like the work that I'm doing under the CRIL. So all of our students have to be sophisticated consumers and good producers of research before they get our degree. Yeah.
So it's, congratulations on your big grant from the Health and Human Services Department, is that right? Mm-hmm. 2.5, that's a lot of money.
Yeah, I'm excited about it.
Yeah.
I mean, we're spreading it among a lot of different groups, so it doesn't go as far as you'd think.
Uh-huh.
But we will be able to hire a new faculty member here on campus, and should also be sponsoring some research assistantships. And hopefully we can build off that as well.
That's great. Anything else you want to talk about with regard to the HPA and all the work you're
doing? It's a great program. Send your kids.
All right, very good.
Or yourselves.
Uh-huh.
We are always interested in more applications. We admit in both the fall and spring semesters currently. And there's lots of information on the College of Nursing website.
85% placement is pretty darn good.
It's a good investment. Mm-hmm. There's some graduate degrees that I would feel kind of guilty peddling right now in this economy, but HPA is not one of them. It's a good investment, and our students are glad that they get the degree.
All right, and you said you have a philosophy student in the program?
Yeah, we've got lots of ex-pre-meds, but we've also got communications majors and philosophy majors and English majors and other folks that are taking their skills and applying them in the fastest growing segment of the economy.
Well, yeah, totally an exciting time
to
be in healthcare. That's right.
Yeah. And particularly health policy. Really, this is a once-in-a-generation opportunity for our students to know more than their bosses do about the policy environment. So it's a neat time to be studying this.
Very good. Well, thanks for joining us.
Sure.
And thank you for joining us on this edition of Health Sciences Update.